Hiya folks, Mr. Wilshaw here. We're going to talk through 10 multiple choice questions at IB level on random and systematic errors. Okay, hopefully 10 questions, 10 minutes, we should be able to do it. So first one, we've got a graph of data. Okay, pretty nice data there, which we'd all like to get from our experiments, but we're being asked to say whether there are systematic or random errors. I'll show you the choices in a second. Before we do so, it's always a really good idea to have a look at the graph itself and think about the straight line, which is why you need a ruler. Okay, now if you notice here, one way of telling that I've got really nice data is if it all sits on a clean straight line like the one I'm going to draw here. I'll draw it now and you should be able to see once I've removed my ruler. I'll tell you what, I'll use a green pen instead so it's a bit clearer. You should be able to see there that there is a lot of nice correlation between my data. There's very little wavering about the straight line that I've drawn, which implies a low random error. Okay, so we can always rule out any arrow and any options which have a large random error. However, we notice here it does not go through the zero. We're looking at a relationship between mass and volume, and we would expect this line to cross the origin. The reason there that has happened is because there is a systematic error here. Okay, so if we look at our choices here, we've got a small random error, but a large systematic. Nice. Okay, question number two. Which of the following will reduce random errors in an experiment? Okay, using an instrument having greater precision, that's one option, checking the calibration, checking for zero, and then repeating readings. The answer here is D. Why? Well, repeating readings allows for the randomness of random error. Remember, repeated readings whenever you're reading something over time, or if you're measuring the diameter in different locations of a ball, for example, repeating that allows for the random fluctuations. What you want to do is do the same experiment multiple times in order to reduce random error. Having greater precision gives me more information, more significant figures, but doesn't necessarily reduce the random error. Checking the calibration is more to do with to check if we are looking at a linear or a nonlinear response from our instrument we're using to measure. And zero error is very much for systematic error. Okay, let's look at number three. Again, we have a graph. We've got masses and weights, and what we're obviously expecting again is that this thing is going to go through the zero, the origin. And again, that's why it's really good if we draw our line. Again, I'll do the same thing. Okay, and we should see, very similar to question one, that actually we've got a nice line of data, low random error, okay, small random error. However, there is a significant systematic error because we haven't crossed the origin. Obviously, if the mass of an object is zero, we expect its weight to be zero. However, this data is not saying that, and there's clearly been some problem with the zero there. Question number three. All right, a bit of a tricky one, this one, because it really depends, because there's very little way of defining this. Hopefully that makes it a bit clearer for you guys. We've got an archer, okay, and he's firing arrows which produce a pattern of hits. Now you're noticing these hits are quite close together, okay? They are quite close together. However, they are not all on the same spot. And that's the key to answering this question, where a lot of people get this one wrong. Let's go through. A, we've got random and systematic errors. That's the answer here, is A. But why is it not B, C, and D? Well, random uncertainties, but no systematic uncertainty. Remember, systematic uncertainty is shown by our arrows, on average, not reaching the bullseye. These are quite clearly all shifted away one distance from the bullseye, and so therefore there is a systematic error. The no random uncertainty, if there was no random uncertainty, then we would have all of the points homed in on each other and exactly the same space. If there was no random and no systematic, well then all of the data would be right on this center point here. Remembering our aim in these kind of bullseye experiments is to reach the bullseye. Okay, that's the true value, so anything away from it would be a systematic error. We have random and systematic uncertainties because there's a spread and they are all an equal distance away from the bullseye. Okay, let's look at this one. Students making values of reading values of G, we expect 9.81. Okay, We're looking for something which is not accurate, but precise. So in precise, we've got a low spread, okay? We've got a low spread. However, we want values which are away from the value we expected. So we look at our data here. Here we've got very nice accurate data. It's very close to 9.81. Here we've got some above and some below, and so therefore there's quite a wide spread there. Here we've got quite a wide spread and we are very far away from our 9.81. Okay, and then down at the bottom we've got some numbers which are very, very close together, but they are clearly not correct, and that is why D is the answer here. We're almost there. Question number six. A steel rule can be read to the nearest millimeter. We've got the length of it is 895, and we've got repeated measurements, all of either 891 or 892, six of each. We take the average of that, it will come out as 891.5. All we have to do is add these guys up and divide them by six. Okay, so are they accurate to within one millimeter? Well, the value you want is 895. We're getting 891.5, which is fairly close, but not close enough. It is not accurate to within one millimeter. Are they precise to within one millimeter? Well, if we look at the deviation, we've got half of the range. The range is 892 minus 891. 1 divided by 2, 0.5. Okay, so we have definitely got precision to within one millimeter, and so therefore, B. Here we go. Question 7. We're expecting h equal to a half gt squared, okay? So if we're plotting any value of h here against any value of t, we are expecting this thing to go through the origin. And therefore, again, there's evidence of some kind of systematic error. And the question is here, what is that systematic error? Remember, a systematic error affects all readings by the same amount. And so therefore, something like error resistance not being taken into account for larger values cannot be valid, because that's only for the large values, only for these guys up here, not for these. We're looking for something which will affect everything. There is a constant delay between starting the timer and releasing the ball. That would explain it, because we're always getting a time which is too big, and too big by the same amount every time. An error in the timer that makes it consistently run fast, well, that would not change the value of t in terms of a systematic error. That would be a scaling error. And then h against t squared, actually, if you plot h against t squared, you would also get a straight line here as well. So let's be. Last ones. Can we do it in the last 2 minutes? Performing the experiment, we want to minimize the uncertainty. How are we reducing the systematic error? Well, key to point here is that we're looking at what a systematic error is. It affects everything in the same amount. And zero errors is always a good way of doing so. Remember, if you're starting to read something and it starts at 0.1, every reading is going to be too big by 0.1. So what we do is we adjust it to the zero position. Measuring things multiple times, diameter and multiple paper clips, and timing these are all not the answer. These are all to do with random error. Student carried out experiment. We've got some data and we want to explain the misnomer. We want to explain this result because we're noticing as time goes on, we've got current going down, 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 up, and then down again, which couldn't explain the anomalous reading. Well, he could have reversed these two readings, so that is a possible answer. Okay, he read the ammeter incorrectly. Again, that could explain it. He took the current reading at the wrong time. Not sure about that one. Okay, we're sure about that one. That could be right. However, here, a systematic error does not apply, because systematic error, again, would affect all of our data points, not just this one. Okay, last one. Student takes measurements of the current in of a resistor of constant resistance. The readings are then used to plot a graph. The systematic error in the current readings, and how could this be identified? Remember, V equal to IR. We are expecting a graph, let me just move this to the side, which is a straight line. However, if there's a systematic error, we're expecting a non-zero intercept, which means that the straight line does not pass directly through the origin. Okay, I hope that's clear. I know it's fast. Feel free to pause the video as you go to make sure that you're understanding the explanations, and please let me know if there's anything else I can do to make it clearer.